Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here. Live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake, also showing live over SPNN in St. Paul. And today's show is kind of a catch-up on a lot of things, but finally, you know, I got some more information on gay marriage, the Supreme Court ruling. We have House Resolution 5, which the U.S. Congress passed today, dealing with federal education and the federal takeover of the state's education system, a totally unconstitutional concept. Education is left to the states. There's nothing in the federal constitution that allows the federal government to have an educational system for the states. So we're going to talk about that and how that affects parental rights and some of the dialogue going on back and forth and the deception in the process. But before we get to those things, I want to talk about the effect that the U.S. Supreme Court decision is having on people in their lives, and it's quite disturbing what's taking place. And bottom line, a peaceful civil battle has begun to rage in the United States. When that turns unpeaceful, I don't know when it will. I hope it won't, but we'll see what happens. Before that, we're just going to make a few comments on some things we talked about before and other things that are in the news right now, kind of to catch up on things. But, you know, this local government channel is paid for by you by having a subscription to Comcast. And so this local area, the Suburban Communication Cable Commission, here, SCC, has its meetings once a month on this night, and just, and we deal with Maplewood, and, you know, and Maplewood's having re-elections for a couple of the city council members, but one of the city council members, MaryLee Abrams, is from Maplewood, is on the commission here, has been appointed to that by Maplewood, and if you've watched any of her behavior in Maplewood, she brings that here too, except she's more attacks the workers here, but she will leave the workers in Maplewood alone when actually they need to be, her job is to hold them accountable. And she's playing a really weird role here with the cable communication. It's like her goal is just to destroy and bash and be argumentative and not be polite. So today, you know, it happened again. And so what she does is she makes these statements that are profound and grandiose and, oh, you know, you're way behind on the negotiations. We're way behind everybody else, you know. And instead of saying, you know, how are we comparing, asking a question, how are we comparing with other cities in this process? Because she doesn't know. She's making the statement, no, we're way behind. And then all the evidence comes out, well, so no, here's where we're at, and, you know, in relationship to everybody else, and we're not way behind. So, it's just her combative style, and what she should be doing is just, okay, if she wants to make a point, make the point through asking questions. And instead of saying, boy, your attorney messed this up, and your attorney needs to talk to our attorney because it's so messed up on this agreement and it was written wrong, she should ask questions, you know, and say, well, what, you know, it seems to me that it looks like something's missing here. I don't know, but... You know, can you have your attorney talk to the city of Maplewood's attorney? You know, so instead of you know, being polite and asking questions and Or, you know, here's how I'm understanding this. Where am I wrong with that? It's an attack. And, of course, that gets the defenses up. And then she starts getting insulting, you know, she's basically grandstanding why she's there. You know, I know what's going on, and, you know, and the Cable Commission has one of the top attorneys in the United States on cable issues. Here, SEC does. And instead of talking to him, you know, it's just kind of going around him in the process. And so, but what happened, because she makes these strong statements, and she took some information from Maplewood's attorney, Canfield, and they both had the information wrong, and so now they're both end up getting embarrassed because of the way MaryLee Abrams handled herself. The truth came out and said, no, this is, you know, here's what it says, and here's where your concern of something that wasn't in there is actually in there, and then it's just kind of embarrassing, you know. So there's just a better way to deal. And I would tell you, if MaryLee Abrams was up for election, she probably wouldn't get reelected. So, you know, in the end, some of the other council members called and said, you know, look, you know, you're just being insulting in what you're doing and combative, and we just, you know, back down a little bit. You know, that was the overall message that was stated. But something interesting happened is that MaryLee Abrams said, don't make this personal. That's not how we handle meetings. We don't make things personal. But what's interesting, because I watched the Maplewood meetings, is that MaryLee Abrams was taught that by Mayor Slawick, because you can't behave that way in the legislature. I mean, if you're going to make your comments, insulting comments, they don't end up being personal. They end up being, you know, said other ways, more polite ways. And MaryLee Abrams was doing personal attacks to other city council members, and she learned that lesson from Mayor Slawick, although Mayor Slawick doesn't know how to run a meeting either, and is not afraid to do personal attacks against the citizens, and especially if you come and as a citizen come and make comments. So what will happen in Maplewood is you come and make a comment, and they get all over you for coming in and make a comment, and then they want to control what you're saying, which is their big thing right now. They want to control the words that are saying, and they want to rebut them, and they actually don't want you to speak. And then when nobody shows up, Kathleen Juneman, city council member, nobody loves us, you know. Well, she's just as phony as can be, you know, when she's playing that game. So, anyway, it was just interesting to watch MaryLee Abrams, and she's supposedly a negotiation expert and kind of a peacemaker. That's what she touts herself as, and just doesn't need to be that way, you know, and it's too bad that she is that way. So, anyway, that's what happened here in the governmental process of the local cable communities. All right, we got a phone call here. Caller, do you have any comments or questions?
Well, we're talking about this issue of respecting the citizens when they come forward to speak.
Right, right.
But there's even a greater, more insidious way of disrespecting citizens, and that is ignoring that they've attended the meeting to speak.
And I couldn't hear you very well. Could you repeat that again?
Ignoring citizens who have come to the meeting to speak.
Oh, right. Not letting citizens speak at all, even though they've signed up and are there to speak.
Absolutely. And I can give you an example of that from my own personal experience. The city council was having a second reading of the natural gas franchise tax.
Mm-hmm.
And they were going to enact it into being a new ordinance. And right. I wanted to come forward. I signed up because I thought it would be a good suggestion that they should have an exemption from the ordinance, those people who qualify for fuel assistance, because sure. this extra tax on their bill is not going to be covered by their fuel assistance dollars. And they are the people who are the least likely and able to afford this very regressive tax. Mm-hmm. Well, they knew that there was somebody there to speak. I'm sure they knew. Why wouldn't they knew? No. I mean, I would sign up.
Yep.
And instead, they just said, well, nothing has changed, so, okay, let's make a vote. And right. that was the end of it.
Yeah. Wow. That's just terrible. And they knew it. The whole thing is they knew somebody was there to speak.
I have reason to believe that they knew. Yeah. I mean, if you have a public sign-in, you sign in.
Right.
How can they not know?
Yeah, exactly. All right, caller, thank you very much. Yeah, so, and this is the game that gets played in other communities, the city of Grant. You know, now it has eliminated visitors' presentation to the extent that only four people can speak, and the mayor chooses who gets to speak. So even though somebody doesn't want to speak, he will call on them, and they will come up, and he says, don't you have something to say? And the guy goes, no, I don't have anything to say. And so he says, yeah, I think you got something to say. Just come up and say something. And so the guy comes up and says, you got a nice shirt there, mayor. And, okay, that's the fourth person. Presentation is closed. Meanwhile, other citizens want to come up and speak. So this is arrogance beyond belief. And it's just it's a tragedy. These people like Mayor Carr and Grant, he's mentally sick, in my opinion. He is a depraved individual beyond depraved. And if you can't argue your case, make some argument for your case, don't be there. You know, take the heat. If you don't like what somebody, just take the heat. You look a lot better and you look a lot more professional. But the way you're behaving like a three-year-old child, you know, and I tell you, you know, great parenting tip here. What you do with a child who throws tantrums, I mean, I did this to my kids. It worked every time. It's just amazing. And I heard it from other parents that did this. The first time a kid throws a tantrum, you get right down there on the ground with them and throw the tantrum yourself. Just mimic everything they're doing, you know. And they don't like it. And they stop. My kids threw a tantrum once, and that was it. They never threw a tantrum after that. And, you know, they learned to communicate and deal with things because they knew it wasn't going to work, okay? And unfortunately, we treat some of our elected officials with kid gloves. They're just people. They're flesh and blood. They're not more important than you. They're not less important. And people idolize these people or give them a respect beyond what they're due. You respect people, but you don't give them a respect beyond what they're due. And because people treat elected officials that way, they behave like spoiled brats, you know, instead of being respectful themselves. So anyway, that's an update on SCC and Maplewood and Grant. Of course, Grant is, man, that I feel sorry for your citizens there because you got so many lawsuits from an arrogant mayor and his two cronies that it's going to cost you a lot of money. It's just too bad. Well, I got some other updates. You know, last week was a very big show where we talked about the Muslim faith and the Muslim Brotherhood in particular and how it got started. And it's important to know that, and I want to draw some distinctions there and some other comments. course, there's a lot of ends of the Muslim group, but it's not the same as, you know, Protestant, Catholic, JWs, Mormons, you know, although I wouldn't classify JWs and Mormons with the Protestant group. At least the Catholics and the Christians have the same definition of who Jesus Christ is. And so in the Muslim community, you know, it's Muhammad. That's the person, the great prophet. And so there isn't any other type of division that way. A lot of the division is then on who's the leader in the faith. But just in the news, you know, it's been talked about Boko Haram out of Nigeria. And they had kidnapped 200 girls from a Christian school. And what has happened recently, and it's been reported in Breaking Christian News and also the Christian Post, is that the parents of over 200 girls from Chibok in Nigeria who were kidnapped by Boko Haram terrorist group last year are now appealing directly to the United Nations for help. In other words, they have no help. And the horrific stories that are coming out, and I'm going to tell you one of these stories. Basically, why these parents are appealing to the United Nations, but I don't think it's necessarily a good idea, because a lot of the United Nations is made up of Muslim countries. But they've given up on the Nigerian government for help. And of course, if they're Christians, they realize that their only hope is not in the government, but in Christ. So, but that doesn't mean you don't stand for what's right. You stand up for what's right, and you call other people to do what is right. And those that say they have the power and want justice and to do what's right, they need to be held accountable in order to do that. But one of the kidnapped girl's father, he's a Nigerian Christian pastor, his name is Mark, is speaking out about the unconscionable death of his daughter Monica and the fact that she refused to deny her faith in Christ. Now, I personalize this. Look at that. This is you, and you have a daughter, okay? And somebody's taking your daughter in the name of a religion and says they're going to force them to convert to another faith and then marry them off as brides, or they'll be killed. And Pastor Mark's daughter, according to him, said she refused to deny her faith in Jesus. So what, according to this Christian Post report, this Pastor Mark was interviewed by the BBC in June as part of an investigation about the missing girls. This was what Pastor Mark told them. I was told that my daughter refused to change her religion. I was told that they dug a hole and buried her from the neck and stoned her to death. To die for the sake of Christ, that's the happiest thing for me. I'm grateful that she did not change her religion. She trusted in God. And Marta, the pastor's wife, added, I believe she died with dignity. Monica is now in heaven because she refused to convert. And what's interesting is this dignity comment here, okay? Because this is what Justice Thomas said about this United States Supreme Court ruling on this fake marriage. This fake marriage is between two men or two women or maybe multiple men and multiple women. I mean, why not? I mean, there is no restrictions on that now based on their legal reasoning, which was not constitutional reasoning. But Clarence Thomas says there is no mention about dignity. And you either have dignity or you don't. The Constitution doesn't give it, and it doesn't take it away. And so nobody can take away your dignity. And that's what this pastor said. She maintained her dignity by believing what she believed and believing it to her death. And so she was buried neck deep, and then rocks were thrown at her head, and she died being stoned. And remember, this is what Muhammad did, and what Muhammad, what he encouraged. And unlike Jesus, who said, if those without sin cast the first stone, and everybody dropped the stones. So there's a different way to deal with things. And it's interesting to note that former Muslims are coming out to speak. And actually, one Muslim, his name is David Nasser, who is a vice president of at Liberty University, which is a Christian college, Jerry Falwell's college. Former Muslim is the vice president, okay, at a Christian college. He had this statement to say, "We Christians are part of the only kingdom where the king of our kingdom died for his enemies. It is us for them, not us against them. We want to see them come to Christ, and we need to maintain a passion for the very people we rise up against, but at the same time, rise up for." Okay, and that's a real big distinction. We are against the behavior that Muslims are doing. Okay. And believe me, you're not a true Muslim unless you're doing these things. That's what Muhammad did. That's what Muhammad said. That's how Muhammad behaved. Okay? And for the Christian, a Muslim is not the enemy. David Nasser said this. Christians, Muslims are not the enemy. They're the prize. They're the prize to win, to show the glory of Christ and the glory of God. And it's a different mindset, Christianity, than the Muslim faith. But not all Christians are Christians, so not all Christians behave that way either. So I just think it's refreshing to hear, in context of what I talked about last week, was just laying out the facts of the Muslim faith, and the concept is, what do I do as an individual who's not a Muslim, but realizing this is the situation that is coming and is already here in America, where already people are being beheaded because they're not Muslims, where already we've been attacked and by real Muslims. And as Muslims will say, there's no such thing as a radical Muslim. We are not radical Muslims. There is no such thing. This is the Muslim faith. This is how we behave. And so in light of that, how do you as a Christian behave? And what do you do when you're kidnapped and you're getting ready to be beheaded? And so we here set up governments. We set up people in order to protect people's liberties. But we don't protect a religion that says kill your neighbor. We've set up freedom of a Christian religion which says, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And so the call is different in Christianity than the Muslim faith. And so, to be very clear, I am not calling for Christians to go out and kill Muslims. That's not what a Christian does. As David Nasser, a former Muslim who is now vice president of Liberty University, says, Muslims are not the enemy, they're the prize for a Christian to win them over. And so just kind of a clarification over, and a different a perspective on last week's show, which laid out the, and so just to remind you, you can go and see last week's show on youtube.com/speechlessmn and watch that show on the history of the Muslim Brotherhood and who they are and how they got to where they are today and just who the players are and the names to know and you know, where does Iran fit in this? Where does Syria fit in this? Where does Sunni? Where does Shiite? Where do all these names and things come together? And why are we importing and getting so many immigrants into the United States from these Muslim countries? How's that happening? Well, it actually happened. It's happening through the United Nations and Christian organizations like our so-called Christian organizations like Lutheran Brotherhood and Catholic Charities. They're bringing in the enemy to us. And instead of putting these people, these refugees, in like countries, they're coming here and then demanding services on us and our communities that is, frankly, breaking the bank and causing a lot of conflict in these communities, especially in St. Cloud. And Representative Tom Emmer is getting an earful up there, and he's not liking it. And of course, Tom Emmer's kind of forgotten his roots. So anyway, we'll see where that goes. All right, remember, this is a live call-in show. You can still call in with your comments or questions, 651-747-3838. If you have them. A couple other information, you know, you've heard about, let's see, immigration on the federal part. And what's interesting, because of the immigration, in particular Mexico, when dealing with Trump statements, and because the Obama administration has changed the law, I mean, totally against our Constitution, he can't change the law. It has to go through Congress before the law can be changed, and he has to sign a bill. He can't change the law without going through Congress. Well, there's been many lawsuits, and what's happened now, which I don't think has gotten out to the press, is that a federal district court judge, and I don't know which one, this came from Jay Sekulow, ACLJ, is the organ, American, I forget the name, but if you Google ACLJ, you should come up with, and Jay Sekulow, you'll come up with this website, but a federal district judge is demanding individual Obama administration officials appear in federal court to answer for deliberate violations of the court order halting President Obama's executive action on immigration. So this federal district court judge halted President Clinton's actions, and then these administrators are going out and ignoring the judge's orders. Okay. So you have a situation, well, I'm sure the administration is saying, you're a judge. You know, you really don't, you're a federal district court judge, you really don't have any say over us. We're going to do what we want. Of course, the Obama administration is saying to the Congress, yeah, you write the laws, but you're not writing the laws we want, so we're just going to do what we want, and now you got to stop us. So Congress takes him to court, and Obama's saying, well, so what? And so what's happened is the federal court issued an injunction, okay, and that's saying that you got to halt President Obama's illegal rewrite of the nation's immigration laws. Okay, well, this federal judge issued a new order, and this happened July 7th, okay, issued a new order that indicates that approximately 2,000 individuals were given various benefits in violation of this court order after the injunction was issued. So the court was first apprised by the government of the violations of its injunction on May 7, 2015. It admitted that the government admitted that it violated this court's injunction on at least 2,000 occasions, violations which have not yet been fixed. This court has expressed its willingness to believe that these actions were accidental and not done purposely to violate this court's order. Okay, so the judge, okay, I'll give you the benefit of the doubt. It was an accident. And with a big government and a big bureaucracy, you can have accidents. Nevertheless, and this is the court's ruling, it is shocked and surprised at the cavalier attitude the government has taken with regard to its efforts to rectify this situation. The government promised this court on May 7th that immediate steps, 2015, were being taken to remedy the violations of the injunction. Yet as of June 23rd, 2015, some 6 weeks after making that representation, the situation has not been rectified. So the judge set a new hearing for August 19th and demanding that the named defendants, and so he's got a court order saying you got to show up, you've been subpoenaed to show up. Johnson, Secretary of Homeland Security, Gil Kerlinkowski, Commissioner of U.S. Customs and Border Protection, Ronald Vitello, Deputy Chief of U.S. Border Patrol, other U.S. border people, U.S. Immigration Customs, Sarah Saldana, appear to show cause, they're ordered to appear to show cause why the administration continues to violate the court's prior order. The judge stated each individual defendant must attend and be prepared to show why he should be not held in contempt of this court. So, which means, and you know, the court date set the 19th, which means they have time, you know, to say, Your Honor, yes, things weren't going well, but between then and now, we got it fixed. Okay, great, super. You know, we're not doing this anymore. We're not violating the law anymore. So it looks like they're going to be held to account. Who knows? So the judge also stated the government has conceded that it has directly violated this court's order in its May 7, 2015 advisory. Yet as of today, 2 months have passed since the advisory, and it has not been remedied and it has not remediated its own violative behavior. That is unacceptable, and as far as the government attorneys are concerned, completely unprofessional. To be clear, this court expects the government to be in full compliance with this court's injunction. And the judge further states, at some point when a non-compliant party refuses to bring its conduct into compliance, one must conclude that the conduct is not accidental but deliberate. If these violations have not been corrected by the end of this month, absent the very compelling evidence, this court will be glad to consider the only logical conclusion is that the government needs a stronger motivation to comply with lawful court orders. Well, very strong words, but you know, what is he going to do if they don't come back? You know, I don't know. Is he going to fine the government? Or can he hold these individuals themselves financially liable or liable job-wise? You know, what is the penalty? Obviously, order to show cause, contempt of court, it'd be jail time that they can do for them. And of course, they would then have to appeal their jail time and all things like that. But it's interesting to note that the Obama administration so far is not cooperating with the court order by the federal judge. All right. Then it was also in the news. This is also came out by the ACLJ, American Center for Justice and Liberty. I think that's what it is. ACLJ. Yeah, I don't know. Look it up for me in there. We'll have it to you by the end of the show. I'm forgetting why I forget. All right. Hey, I found out that I have somebody that watching the show that is doing a best of, editing my show and putting a best of speechless. That's the
American Center for Law and Justice.
Okay, American Center for Law and Justice is the name. Thank you, crew. Appreciate that. But anyway, he's doing the best. Well, there's one for your best of. I'm forgetting why I forget. Okay. All right. Well, hey, you know, we've heard about all the IRS targeting conservative charities and Tea Party 501c4s. And what has come out very recently in documents, actually from Judicial Watch, an official memo from October 2010 of a meeting between Lois Lerner and officials at the Department of Justice and the FBI to plan for the prosecution of targeted nonprofit organizations. A lawsuit filed under the Freedom of Information Act produced the documents, which included the memo, as well as revelations that the Justice Department wanted IRS employees to turn over sensitive documents before giving them to Congress. This is according to Judicial Watch. An IRS document confirms that the organization supplied the FBI with 21 computer disks containing 1.25 million pages of confidential information for more than 113,000 tax returns. You got to understand this. The FBI was asking for information from the IRS without a warrant. Okay. This was a fishing expedition. They can't do that. There has to be probable cause. So the Department of Justice was working, and what was happening, the FBI, the Department of Justice, and the IRS were meeting together to figure out a way and to figure out avenues to go after Tea Party groups. That's the allegation here. Okay, and that's the smoking gun document that shows that that's what they did. They tried to do that. So some of the meeting notes from this high-level October 8, 2010 meeting show that former top IRS official Lois Lerner and several other IRS officials met with the section chief and other attorneys from the Department of Justice, the Criminal Division, Public Integrity Section, and one representative from the FBI to discuss recent attention to the political activity of exempt organizations. Those discussions focused on several possible theories to bring criminal charges against these conservative groups. In other words, they had no information. They had no reason to believe that a crime was being taken place. They were meeting to go after conservative groups and to figure out a way to do it without any evidence of there being any crimes or misdeeds committed. This level of collusion between the IRS, FBI, and Department of Justice at the time conservative groups were being targeted for their political beliefs by Lerner's division of the IRS is suspect, to say the least. However, it is exacerbated by the fact that Lerner and the Department of Justice continued these conversations for years. Nearly 3 years later, in fact, 2 days before Lerner issued her fake apology or faux apology for targeting conservatives, Lerner wrote an email to the chief of staff for the acting commissioner of the IRS explaining ongoing discussions with senior Department of Justice officials to piece together false statement cases about applicants. Wow. I mean, this is huge. Yeah. So, that's going to be an interesting update. And the timeline of all this is essential. And having these emails out there, what they're saying, what they're doing. I think it's pretty much over, and so it's just a matter of the major press picking up on this issue. Whether they will or not, who knows? Okay. Now, I want to bring in another issue here, and because we talked about Common Core in the past, and or Race to the Top, or No Child Left Behind, all these federal programs dealing with education. And it's important to understand that the federal government should not be involved in education. It should be left alone to the states. There shouldn't be any federal student loan type things going on. It's just not necessary. All it's done is inflated the cost of education and made our country and our students be in huge financial debt and contributed to that debt. And so it's a terrible thing that's going on. But Representative Klein on this H.R. 5, which they are calling the Student Success Act, his comments about it and his spin on it, it's receiving enthusiastic support from conservatives because it does a number of things. Prohibits the federal government from dictating what academic standards can and cannot be taught in schools. Okay, and the key word there is federal government. And that's a good thing. And that's an important thing to have take place. Believe it's already in the Constitution, so to pass a law that says that they can't is kind of redundant. But who obeys the Constitution? It allows parents to opt their children out of federal testing. So he says it repeals a one-size-fits-all accountability standard, which is, I think is very important that it does. I mean, if these things are happening, this is good. But also remember that the federal government is not running the education system now. It's corporations. If you've watched my past shows, especially on Common Core and what the liberals have to say about Common Core, you'll find that when they talk about we don't want the federal government in the education system, they're telling half the story. No, the federal government isn't pushing Common Core. They're exactly right. It's the two corporations, Bill Gates and Pearson Publishing. They're providing the financing. They're pushing for a national education system, and they're doing so. It's going to be a corporate school system taken over by two companies because those two companies are going to be managing the tests, and you're going to have to study to the test. And then everybody ends up being mediocre. You got one level of achievement, and that's it. Representative Klein from Minnesota says it eliminates 69 ineffective, duplicate, and unnecessary programs. That will be great. It repeals mandates in current No Child Left Behind law that dictate how much money school districts must spend. Okay. It clearly allows for any state that does not want to comply with any requirement under any program in this bill to opt out. Of course, they won't get any federal money, or can they opt out and still get the federal money? Empowers parents and protects parental rights. My understanding that this does do that. It says it does that. And protects the autonomy of religious schools, private schools, and homeschools. Now, the Senate has a separate bill, and that passed today, but there's some significant differences, so that's going to a conference committee. And the Senate bill S-1177. But some of the conservative groups out there that understand this education and the Student Success Act, of course, that's, you're just changing the name of the same thing, okay? And what they're saying is that there are good things in this bill, But all it is, it's a rewrite of No Child Left Behind, but it's got some horns to it. What do they mean on that, I do not know. But it had some nice amendments to it. Gave parental opt-out rights more power. It gives states Common Core opt-out ability more likelihood. And it seems to me that these amendments are a little optimistic cork stuffed hopefully into the side of the Titanic. Okay, so I mean, if you have an opt-out to Common Core and the states have that opt-out, they could use it, but each school district can adopt Common Core themselves, and the state can still adopt Common Core, and then the parent, the teacher, is left in a bad position, which most teachers say this will lead to mediocre teaching, and then they gotta teach to the test, and you'll just be testing students all the time instead of educating and helping the student learn and how to learn. But what the conservative groups are saying is the language of this bill is not on their side. And why it's not on their side, is that, well, their quote is, it says, it sounds magnificent. No officer or employee of the federal government shall directly or indirectly through grants, contracts, or other cooperative agreements mandate, direct, incentivize, or control a state, local education agency or school-specific instructional content, academic standard, and assessments, curricula, or program of instruction, including any requirement, direction, incentive, or mandate to adopt a Common Core state standards developed under the Common Core State Standards Initiative or any other academic standards common to a significant number of states, nor shall anything in this act be construed to authorize such officer or employee to do so. And that's a really good thing, but Common Core isn't coming through the federal government or through the states, it's coming through corporations, okay? But what, as described in this, there's so much, and this is a small gem. If that were true, great, that'd be fantastic. But it's like having a very thin slice of meat with, you know, 2 10-pound hamburger buns on either end of it. In other words, it will get swallowed up and be meaningless with all the other language that goes on in this bill. They say that there are hundreds of pages. This bill is hundreds of pages long and are designed to deceive well-meaning people, and they do. The prohibitive section that I just read to you a little while ago is very thin, and so there's so much language in the bill that contradicts that one sentence. Not only in the bill, but the whole structure of education reform dwarfs that little good sentence. The whole race to the top set up a federal power structure over testing and standards that one sentence cannot now overcome. And of course, that was the whole thing with Common Core. We control the testing, we control what the teacher teaches. And so with all this federal testing that will be mandated with the federal money, it will end up teaching to the test, and therefore controlling the education system and what's taught to the kids, and ends up being a federal government. Remember, we are made up of separate states, 50 separate states, and things that are not told by these states for the federal government to do are left to the states. And education is one of them. The federal government, there's nothing in there on education to the federal government. Okay, and so the states should have their say in the education. And, you know, and just to reiterate here, the curriculum always follows the test, because you as a teacher, if your students aren't doing well compared to the test, then you get in trouble in this deal. So the bottom line here is, and why it's going to pass. See, that's the big thing. You got a Republican-controlled House You got a Republican-controlled Senate, and they're going to pass a bill that President Obama will be willing to sign on to. Hello? Is there a problem here? Okay. You figure it out. And so there are a number of Republicans that did not vote onto this. So this is a bill designed for the Democrats and the corporate Republicans. Okay? The corporate Republicans, like Klein, in my opinion, are in favor of this bill. Folks, watch out. Pay attention to that issue. It's coming your way, and it's got to be blocked. And you got to show up. If you're not showing up to the places you need to show up to fight these things, and March 1st, 2016, if you're not there that day at your precinct caucus, you've given it over. You've given up your authority and your power and your say. So you got to be there. If you want these things changed, and if you want the federal government out of state education, you got to be there, and you got to be able to tell your representatives, what are you doing? I don't want this. That's where it all starts. Now, you're going to say, you go to precinct caucus and you say, well, nobody showed up. Yeah, but now you get elected to the next level, and now you're representing a lot more people. Or you say, well, only four people showed up. Well, so what? Well, there was 30 people in the room, and I didn't get elected. Well, at least you tried, okay? But not trying, that's ridiculous. Don't say you believe in something and then don't show up when that's the place to express your beliefs and get your values out there. And for many years, I didn't understand that was the process. And I would say there's even when I was younger, there's some years that I was too afraid. Well, that's over with. Eventually you got to grow up until your young people out there that want to raise your children and your beliefs and your faith, you better show up because somebody else is trying to take it away. And there's a whole bunch of people that are trying to take it away. But there's a lot more people on your side, but those people don't show up. Okay, so you got to get your friends to go and show up. We didn't get into some of the consequences that's happening because of the the Supreme Court ruling on marriage and establishing a new standard for marriage that has not existed in history before. But somehow our five Supreme Court justices are so enlightened that they just whatever they wanted made up their own social institution right then and there, in violation of what the people have made up and what God has made up. So there are consequences, and we're not going to get into deep discussion here, and we'll probably have to do that next week. But one judge in Ohio. A lesbian couple came in, wanted to get married, and he said, I don't do that. I apologize for the couple for the delay they experienced and wish them the best. And he sent them to another judge, and that other judge ended up marrying them. But his reason, he said he was going to continue to perform traditional marriages, but this violates his religious faith and his conscience, and so he's not going to do it. So it's a big deal to do that, and there's going to be consequences. This is going to go to court, and it's going to head up to the Supreme Court, and we're going to see whether the freedom of religion trumps freedom or what our dignity. Okay, so. That's how it works. And of course, this judge knows that. You got to misbehave according to social standards in order to get to the court to get them to correct their wrongs. and maybe by the time it gets to the court, things will be different, and this case will end up changing things. So the judge did make a declaratory statement here. On Monday, July 6th, I declined to marry a non-traditional couple during my duties assignment. The declination was based upon my personal and Christian beliefs established over many years. I apologize to the couple for the delay they experienced and wish them the best. The court has implemented a process whereby same-sex marriages will be accommodated. I will continue to perform traditional marriage during my duties assignment. I am also seeking an advisory opinion from the Supreme Court of Ohio at this time as to whether or not I can opt out of the rotation. Upon receipt of the advisory opinion from the Supreme Court, I will abide by its decision. Of course, they may decide he's got to marry, and then he'll probably resign as a justice. Of course, this is a way to force Christians out of the governmental process. All right, we got to close up here, and I got no sound in here, just to let you know. Alabama Chief Justice Roy Moore, I will not be live 2 weeks from now, but I will have a conversation with I won't have a conversation with him. Randall Terry will have a conversation with Justice Roy Moore, and we'll play that video so you can see the whole thing. Very informative on the Constitution. If you didn't know the Constitution, this will give you a lot of information. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
To me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're long gone. The days go by. Set some fire.